A very good afternoon to DDGATS 2020 participants. Once again, on behalf of DDGATS 2020 Training Committee Chairman, Dr. G.N. Sastri, I welcome you all for the Vertical 1 session of DDGATS 2020 Training Program. Today, in Vertical 1 session, will be delivered by Dr. Hemant Kumar Srivastava. Dr. Srivastava is an Associate Professor in Department of Medicinal Chemistry in Naipal, Guwahati. And he has completed his PhD in chemistry in the year of 2004 from RML University. And after a couple of postdocs, he worked as a research scientist at CSIR IICT for 3 years under the mentorship of Dr. G.N. Sastri. And he has received various prestigious awards, includes Young Scientist Award in the year of 2005, DST Fast Track Award in the year of 2009, and Ramanujam Fellowship in the 2015. Dr. Srivastava has expertise on applying various chemo and bioinformatics techniques and also computer-aided drug design approaches. He has efficiently utilized densitally functional theory and conceptual DFT-based parameters in computer-aided drug design. With this small introduction, I request Dr. Srivastava to deliver the talk on ligand-based approaches in drug discovery. Sir, please.
Thank you, Dr. Nagmani, for the nice introduction. It is a matter of great pleasure for me to be associated with this program, and thanks to the director CSIR NIST, who is also my mentor, Professor G. Narayani Sastri. And I also thank the entire CSIR SRTP team, who is doing a tremendous amount of work to deal all the applicants and to bring so much of knowledgeable people as eminent scientists and lectures from various experts. And with this, today I'm going to talk about ligand-based approaches in drug discovery. So this shows that how the drug discovery were carried out in primitive eras. Like this was how Dr. Arnold Moray is conducting an experiment to test the theory that most great scientific discoveries were hit by an accident. So what he is doing, he is having a big laboratory and then he has closed eyes and then he is putting something somewhere and then thinking that some drugs may be discovered. So earlier many drugs were identified by chance, and like penicillin, mirvin, lysergic acid, dimethylamide, and many other drugs which were discovered by chance. But in the current world, there is a very less chance to get the drug discovery by a chance. So considering this, in drug discovery and drug development, so in drug discovery, we need to lead compound. That is a new candidate which are discovered as lead compound, which shows some kind of activity for any kind of treatment. And drug development is, once you find the lead molecule, and then you need to test that drug, test their efficacy, toxicity, applicability, and several other parameters, and find the suitability of synthesis and all, to make it, to bring that molecule in the market. That is called drug development. So compound with useful pharmacological activity is a lead compound. If you find a lead, you need to go for drug development to bring that lead molecule into the market. For doing this, in the advanced drug discovery phase, we have several tools and several techniques like biochemical pathway analysis, like assay development, protein structure prediction, virtual combinatorial chemistry, QSAR modeling, quantum mechanics, ADM. I mean, you can name many of the techniques which are available: molecular docking, artificial intelligence, machine learning, and many, many, many diverse areas and diverse fields. They utilize those techniques to get the new drug and to develop a drug for a given disease. And then after this target identification, hit identification, lead generation, and then preclinical studies, then they go for clinical trials before you get FDA approval for the drug. So advanced drug discovery becomes very complicated. Although this brings a lot new drugs, this brings a lot of understanding for the community that how drug works, it works, and what changes we can make this might make it better drug. But all this, we need to do so much of collaboration and from various fields need to join hands together for the advanced drug discovery. Let's talk about lead. What is the criteria to become a molecule, to a lead molecule, or to a drug-like molecule, or to a drug? So first of all, they have to study pharmacodynamical properties. What is that? That is studying its efficacy, its potency, its selectivity, so that any drug molecule, if it is not selective, if it is not potent enough, or if it is not efficient enough, there is no point to take it to further, because there is a very good chance that it will fail in the clinical trials or in the very even much before clinical trials. So better first to study pharmacodynamical properties. After this, physicochemical properties like its water solubility, its stability of that molecule, whether that molecule is stable or it's breaking in very light environment also. And then pharmacokinetic properties like metabolic stability, toxicological aspects. And then when all of this is, when this lead molecule passes all of these tests, then we test it is ease of its synthesis and then patentability. So once we identify a lead molecule, it is very important to find what kind of structural features are responsible for the biological activity of that lead molecule. Because once if you find that structural feature, you can remove the other features from that molecule which are not important. That will reduce the cost of the molecule, that may reduce the toxicity belongs to that molecule and many other things. And also, you can try to improve that feature so that this lead molecule may have a better activity. So finding this feature is called the pharmacophore modeling. There are two known methods. There are two very important methods for pharmacophore modeling. One is a direct method, and another is called indirect method. What is direct method? Direct method is that when you have the information of ligand and receptor both, and then you take both the things into consideration for finding the pharmacophore, that will be called direct method. But for most of the molecules, we don't have available binding site information, available crystal structure, and available proteins and all. So it is very, very difficult to go for direct method because that information may not be available for any new molecule. Then we go for indirect method. Indirect method is that you don't have any information of structure or any information of binding site or any information of protein. You just have the structure of the ligand or the structure of the lead molecule. Then what you can do, suppose you have this ROH. This you can convert it to ROR. Means that there will be no H available, and then you can understand whether this OH group was responsible for the activity or not. Similarly, this in RNH2, if you replace this H2 with NCOR, then also you will be able to understand that what structural feature, if this structural feature was responsible for the activity or not. So some this type of small test can help to find pharmacophore and then can help to understand which structural feature is really responsible for the activity of that lead molecule. So once this is all done, then pharmacokinetic properties. Pharmacokinetic properties includes adsorption, distribution, metabolism, excretion of a drug, and toxicological behavior. All this is very, very important, because if a molecule, if a lead molecule cannot be adsorbed in the body, it may not be work as a drug. If not be, if it cannot be to the desired places, it will not be a drug. Suppose it, you develop, you are thinking for this lead molecule to work on some specific target or some specific disease, and it is working on somewhere else, then and that is making some kind of toxicity, then it will be a very bad drug. So distribution is very, very important. And after distribution, we have to understand the metabolism. That is the most important in ADMET, because if you cannot metabolize a drug, then it will not be useful, because metabolism is very, very important. And once metabolism is done, then the drug has to go out from the body. That is called excretion. So it should not stay in the body for so long to bring some toxicity and to bring some undesired effect. So, and then we also have to test the toxicological behavior of that drug, so that in the later phase, in clinical trials or in preclinical studies, it will not fail. So once the identified drug molecule or the identified lead qualified all these testing, including ease of synthesis, etc., it goes for preclinical and clinical trials, followed by approval for marketing from FDA. So what is preclinical and clinical studies? Preclinical studies means extensive testing in animal models. So this testing needs to be done to determine safety before we can go for trial on humans. And very specifically, side effect of this drug need to be monitored, need to be assessed, and must be eliminated before we can go for any kind of testing. Yeah. So prior to beginning the clinical trials, this IND application must be submitted for FDA approval. Once it is approved, then we will go for phase one clinical trial. This is like this lead molecule will be tested on some 100 people where they are healthy, they are not patients. So this drug will be tested on these 100 people for the effect on human body. Once it is passed this, then it will go for phase two clinical trial. This is a group of 100 to 500 people, and effect of this drug will be tested on these people, including adverse event, side effect, efficacy. This all will be tested in this phase. Once this phase is completed, it will go for phase three trials, which will be a really larger group, like 1,000 to 5,000 patients, in order to generate statistically significant data, so that they will perform some high-level statistical analysis from this data to understand the effect of drug in this trial. This is very important to mention that only 12% of the drug make it to this stage. And this is a very important stage. And once the drug passed from this stage, there is a very good chance that it will get FDA approval, and also it will go to the market. And any information obtained from the statistical analysis will be given on the label of the drug, and it will also be explained in the explanation of the drug. So drug discovery and development, as I said, this is a collective efforts. Many people, like medicinal chemistry, which is very important, natural product chemistry, pharmacology, biotechnology, synthetic biology, clinical nanotechnology, structural biology, genomics, proteomics, system biology, and many others, they come together for drug discovery. But when you bring computers in drug discovery, then there are many others like molecular modelers, computational chemists, computational biologists, and people who do target identification, multi-scale modeling, various kind of informatics like bioinformatics, chem informatics, and all other kind of informatics. And nowadays, we are using machine learning to make the most of these steps automated. This includes artificial intelligence and big data. And this molecular dynamic simulation need to be performed after we do all kind of modeling studies to understand the stability and to understand the ligand receptor interaction in much detailed way. And then we also perform QMMM calculations for modeling the reaction mechanism so that we will understand the mechanism of the reaction, not only the mechanism of the reaction, but also the intermediates involved during the reaction so that we will understand if on the process of this reaction, is there any toxic intermediates are formed or not. So all this, if we come together for drug discovery using computers, then it will be very easy for anybody to find a lead molecule to take to the development process and then understand the complete mechanism of interaction and mechanism of reaction. So today we are going to talk about computer-aided drug design. This was very general introduction which I included to because there are many students and this is mostly for the students. So I thought that a general explanation of drug discovery will be important for them to understand if they don't know about it. If we talk about computer-aided drug design, so we can do it as structure-based drug design and we can also do it using ligand-based drug design. What is a structure-based drug design? A structure-based drug design means the structure of lead molecule is available as well as the structure of the target, the structure of the protein where this lead molecule goes and binds is also available. So if both these things are available, then one can perform a structure-based drug design. And for getting the structure, one can do cryogenic electron microscopy or X-ray or NMR. And if none of these is possible, then person also perform homology modeling to find the homologous protein structure. I'm not going to details for the structure-based drug design because there will be another on this in this CSIRTP very soon. Ligand-based drug design is like I already explained, understanding pharmacophore and quantitative structure activity relationship and also celerity search. So pharmacophore means the feature of the structure which is responsible for the activity. QSAR is a quantitative structure activity relationship. This talk will be focused on much detail about this QSAR. So you see in this figure that all these structures are very, very similar. Although these structures are very similar, we can very clearly see that the activity varies from 4.8 to 8.7. So finding why very structurally similar molecule behave in a different way and gives different kind of activity is called quantitative structure activity relations. Earlier it was structure activity relationship, which means that chemicals with similar molecular structures have similar effects in physical and biological systems. But this is not really true because many molecules which are very similar have very different biological activity and have very behavior. So to understand that, a quantitative measure was introduced in SAR and then the extent of an effect varies in a systematic way with variations in molecular structure is called quantitative structure activity relationship. I will explain in much more detail in the coming slides about the QSAR in drug discovery and why it is important. So what is QSAR? QSAR is the function of properties. That property can be a structural property, chemical property, or any kind of property of the molecule. You don't know the target, you don't know the binding site, but you know the structure of the ligand or structure of the lead molecule. And if you know the structure, you can get some numerical numbers from the structural feature, from the chemical feature, or from any other property. And that property, if you relate with the activity, it will be quantitative activity relationship. So to find a mathematical relationship between biological activity of a molecular system and its properties is QSAR. In other words, the structure of a compound influences its properties and biological activity, and it is possible to find a relationship between them. And if it is possible to find a relationship between them, this QSAR helps to find that relationship in an efficient manner. And then once we have the QSAR model, we can predict the activity of any similar molecule which are not yet synthesized or which you can think of. Why do we QSAR? So first of all, if you take one benzene ring and put four different substitution at four different position on that benzene ring, there will be some more than 100,000 possibility, and it is not possible to synthesize these 100,000 molecules. What is the solution then? The solution is that you synthesize a small number of molecules, like 10 or like 20 molecules, and then perform quantitative structure activity relationship. And with the help of this data, you synthesize another 20 molecules and then again perform QSAR. And then when you complete this cycle, you will be able to understand completely the responsible feature of all these ligands or of all these substitution, that what kind of substitution can help you to get the desired properties of these ligand. So it means that within 100 or 200 synthesis, you will be able to understand this completely. So then you need not synthesize these 100,000 molecules. Just 100 or maximum 200 synthesis, you will be able to understand completely. But the suggestion is that first 20 molecules and then QSAR, and then again on the data, whatever you got from these 20 molecules and QSAR, you apply that and then get another 20 molecules, and then you apply that and get another 20 molecules. So like that, if you go, you will be able to synthesize those molecules within very limited time and then get the desired activity. But QSAR can be used in combination with other type of information to minimize testing, for example, animal testing. Suppose if you want to test all these 100,000 molecules on the animals, you just think about the cost, you just think about the how much animal probably has to die. But by using QSAR, this will be drastically reduced. This will be exponentially reduced. And then also it will reduce the cost, because you need not synthesize these many molecules, you need not test these many molecules, and then obviously it will reduce the cost. QSAR, ligand-based QSAR, is used when there is little or no receptor information. This I already explained, that if there is no structural information, then this type of approach we follow, that is called ligand-based drug discovery. So QSAR can be applied for drug design and for prediction of activity And also it can be applied for prediction of toxicity, that is chemical toxicity or environmental toxicity, prediction of molecular property. So QSAR is only activity relationship. It can be property relationship, it can be toxicity relationship, or it can be any kind of relationship. Because if you have a data and you have the chemical structure, you have a very good chance to generate the model to predict the property or the activity or the toxicity of any kind of unknown molecule if your data is good and if your model is good. So that's why QSAR is a lot applicable in pharma industry and in many other places where we perform structure, activity or property or toxicity relationship in quantitative way. Before you go for QSAR, there is some points which need to be taken care of. Like your input data should be very good, as numerous as possible, correct, representative, homogeneous data. It's not like you take various kind of activity like MIC50 and IC50 and you mix this. So it has to be homogeneous. It should be preferably from the same lab, because if it will be from the same lab, the chances of getting the error will be in similar way. If it will be from different, you must have meaningful structural information. What does it mean? It means that you must get the correct chemical structure with using density functional theory calculations. This all, if somebody wants some details, they can see this. This is all available, very detailed in the literature. We also worked on DFT-based QSAR. And then there are so many good studies and good papers are available in the literature. And predictive models. So whatever model you generated, it should be giving you some kind of prediction. So that you should test this by dividing your molecules in the training and test set, so that you can predict the activity of the unknown molecules easily. So in other words, if you put garbage in, it will be garbage out. Many people say this, and then this is not my saying, that the model will only be as good as the data used to develop it. So before you start any kind of QSAR, you must see all this, that first of all, your data sets would be very all your data sets would be very, very clean. If your data set is not clean, then you will not get any meaningful result. And that is why there are many, many failures in QSAR. If you perform QSAR, which we have proven several times, if you perform QSAR by following all the protocols, there are very good chances that you get a very good model, and also you can predict the activity of any unknown molecule. Well, QSAR has so many limitations that it may have false correlation. As I already said, that there may be some error in the biological data, or there will be some error in the chemical structure. And then if you try to generate a model with these errors, it will give you only false correlation. It may say that, yeah, it's a very good model with very high statistical parameters, with good correlation coefficient, with good cross validation coefficient, and with all the tests it is getting passed. But that correlation will be false because it is based on the data, or it is based on the structure. The limitation is that if you have very small data set, like less than 10 molecules, then it will be very difficult to generate a good model, because your model is based on the property of the molecule. And property cannot be reflected by just one or two descriptors, which I will explain later what is descriptor. But a property cannot be explained with just by one or two structural features or one or two parameters obtained from the structure. So what does it mean? It means that if your data set is not large enough, you cannot use many structural features to generate the model. So suppose one structure is there for generating a model, only 10 of those structures you have, then as per rule, you cannot have more than two structural features. It should be 1:5. If you have 5 molecules, you can use maximum one descriptor or maximum one structural feature. So if your data set is just 10 molecules, you cannot use more than two descriptors, then it may not reflect the complete property space. It may not reflect the complete property, just those two structures. But if your data set, if your training data set is large enough, suppose you have 100 molecules, then there is a chance of having some more than 5 or 6 structural features to include to generate the QSAR model. That structural feature may be sufficient to explain the complete property or complete property space of that molecule. So in short words, bigger data set is always better, and less error in chemical structure and biological data is always better. So because of this, many QSAR models cannot be used to predict the activity of newly designed compounds. There are many successful applications, and we have also tested so many of them. We also generated so many successful QSAR models. But we also do not expect QSAR will work all the time, because there may be several problems, overfitting problems, how to deal with the statistical quality, outliers, and how reliable is the prediction. So all this has to be tested again and again and again. And then this test has to be also be experimentally should also be included during this process, so that whatever the result is coming, you go and talk to the experimentalist, they test that, and then you get some more data, and then again you do this. So continuously, if you do it for 3-4 times, there will be a very good chance that you get a very good QSAR model. But if it is not possible, then QSAR modeling will be very limited. It has a lot of limitations. That limitation also include applicability domain, like physicochemical, structural, or biological space, or any knowledge or information on which the training set of the model has been developed. That is called applicability domain. And if you are not able to find the proper applicability domain, this will not be a good model. And then there, we already discussed that there will be many activity outliers. There will be many descriptors outliers. So outliers means, suppose you have 100 molecules, and out of those 100, some 4 or 5 molecules are those which are not following any trend. They are just out of the other 95 molecules. Then those 5 molecules will be called outliers. So there can be activity outliers, and then there can also be descriptor outliers. So how to deal with these outliers? How to deal with the statistical quality and prediction reliability and all this? This is also a limitation of QSAR. Because if you can understand the outliers, you can simply take them out and generate the model. But then what to do with those outliers? How to know whether your model is correct, or those structures are not correct, or the activity of those structures are not correct? It is a very difficult task to understand. So that's why there are a lot of limitations in any kind of QSAR. But in spite of these limitations, QSAR has attained tremendous success in last 20 years. Almost all pharmaceutical industries, they are using QSAR technique to understand the structure activity relationship and to predict the structures prior to their synthesis. So they also use a lot of ligand and structure based approaches to find the best molecules. If we talk about history, then it was in 1969, Hans said that the biological activity may be the function of parameters. And then Brown and Fraser in 1868 told that physiological activity is a function of chemical structure. In 1893, Richard said that biological activity is a function of physicochemical properties. And in 1897, Overton, and in 1899, Mayer told that narcotic activity may be a function of lipophilicity. So all these are the basis of QSAR, that if physiological activity can be the function of chemical structure and physicochemical properties can be the function of biological activity, and all this information, this was over a period of time, helped us to understand and to develop the field of quantitative structure activity relationship. There are 1D, 2D, and 3D, and several other D QSAR, which I will explain in the next slides. One can get the molecular descriptors. This also I will explain that what is constitutional, electronic, geometrical, physicochemical, steric, quantum chemical or topological descriptors, and several other kind of descriptors. Descriptors are the properties of the molecule expressed in numbers. And then we have to do pre-processing like normalization, standardization, descriptor selection, and outlier detection. So descriptor selection is also one very important point, because if you cannot find the good descriptors, in other words, if you cannot find the good property of the molecule, you cannot explain the activity of that molecule. So this is very, very important to select the descriptor which can explain, which can really explain the property of the molecule. Once we do this, then there are several methods like multiple linear regression analysis, partial least square analysis, support vector machine, and also random forest, and several other machine learning based methods for generating model. Model means one equation you will get where, based on the property, you can predict the activity. And that model need to be validated by several statistical and other parameters, like correlation coefficient, cross validation coefficient, mean squared error, and root of mean squared error, and several other parameters. That also will be like training and test set division and all. And this graph, it shows the training set and test set. So red dots are test set, and blue dots are training set. And this line shows that this is a very good model because all these dots are very close to the line. And this is a measure that how fitted these data points are. So once you get a very good line, it shows that there is a good chance that your model is good. But this is not the only measure. So in 1972, John Toplitz, they said that non-statistical method to automate the HANS approach. So this is a very good contribution in 1972, which where these people have used non-statistical method and automated HANS approach. Marshall in 1979, he extended the 2D approach to QSAR by explicitly considering the conformational flexibility. So he has taken various conformation, and then because of that, we moved from 2D to 3D QSAR in 1979. In 1980, Hofinger and co-workers, they explained molecular shape analysis, and then this also was a very good contribution in the development of QSAR. In 1988, Richard Kramer, he has introduced TOMFA, and that has brought tremendous success in the history of QSAR, which is like this related to the shape dependent esteric and electrostatic field for molecules to their biological activity. So after that, there are a lot of TOMFA based QSAR model and also TOMCA based QSAR models were developed, and it was very successful. So currently, what is that we can get the activity data set. We can get the activity data set from various databases, from literature, from patents, or from various in-house biostage data and various libraries available online. So once we have a data set, we can go for removing duplication, checking for sample endpoints, and remove salt form and etc. So this is called like data curation. Once it is done, then we calculate the molecular descriptor. But before we calculate the molecular descriptor, we have to optimize or we have to minimize the chemical structure which we are going to use the molecular descriptor. So for the minimization, as I already explained, one can use molecular mechanics or one can use quantum mechanics. I prefer to use density functional theory based method, which is also a quantum mechanics, but with some kind of approximation. And then once you have the minimized structure, you will get the better quality descriptor. So then we divide our data set into training and test set. Training set means the part of the data which we use to select the descriptor, which we use to train ourselves for generating a good QSAR model. And test set means that once the model is generated, then we use this set, the molecule of the test set, to predict and see whether we are able to predict the activity or not, or the property or not. So this is called division in the training and test set. This is very important because if you cannot predict the activity of the same series, it will be very, very difficult to predict the activity of unknown molecule. So if you have some 50 molecule or some 200 molecules in your data set, it's better to have some 20% as test set and 80% as training set. So once you divide the training set, then you can generate the model, and model validation can be like leave one out, leave two out, and leave many out validation. What is leave one out? Leave one out means that from the whole data, you take one molecule out and then generate the model. And based on that model, you predict the activity of the molecule which was left. Now you put that molecule in the data set, remove the second molecule out. And like that you do for the entire data set to check your data, to check your model very rigorously. So that you will be predicting all the molecules at least one time. And this is called leave one out validation. Similarly, one can do leave 2 out or leave 30% out or leave many out validation. Suppose you do leave 10 out, so you take 10 molecules out, generate the data set, and then predict the activity of those 10 molecules. If you are able to predict the activity of those 10 unknown molecules, I think your data is good. Then you put that 10 molecule again in the data set and then remove another 10 molecules and so on. So it will be a very rigorous validation. There are some things to remember: the data set of chemicals, endpoints and descriptor values, test and training set, outliers and applicability domain. This I already explained. And QSAR quality doesn't depend on any software or what kind of method you are going to apply. QSAR quality is depend entirely on the quality of your data. That includes the activity and the structure. If those two are good, there is a very good chance that you get a very good QSAR model. And you should get the correct descriptors. Correct descriptors means you should get the correct numbers which explain the property of the molecule. And then selection of descriptors should be optimum, not less, not more. So not less, not more means, as I already said, that if you have very minimum descriptor, you will not be able to explain the entire chemical space. And if you have a lot of descriptor, it will become very noisy and your data will become invalid. And correlation coefficient, which is R square, is not only measure to check the quality of your data. There are many others. So you should always find, you should always validate your generated model with all kind of statistical validation and external validation. Once your statistical validation and external validations are done, then only you should try to predict the unknown molecules. So what is 1D QSAR and what is higher D QSAR? 1D QSAR means just one dimensional QSAR, where you correlate the pK or log P value without formula of the compound. It reflects only the composition of the molecule. You don't have anything, no information is available. No structure, no binding site, nothing is available. But you have log P and you have pK, then you can perform 1D QSAR. 1D QSAR has very limited effect. It is not considered a very good QSAR model because it is very, very limited. Then 2D QSAR, which is very popular and which has given us a lot of success in QSAR. This is like correlation with the structural pattern. This contains information about the structure of the compound, and it also reflects topology of the molecule. So this is called 2D QSAR. If you have the structure of the compound and if you understand the topology, it is, you can generate very good 2D QSAR model. 3D QSAR model is like, other than composition and topology, you also have a special shape of the molecule for one conformation only. You understand the composition, you understand the topology, and you understand the special shape for one conformation, then it will be called 3D QSAR. In current world, 2D and 3D QSAR are the only popular QSAR. 1D QSAR will not give any kind of information. And higher than 3D QSAR is not efficient enough to apply to millions of molecules. So if your data set is small, you probably can afford to go for higher D QSAR, but 2D and 3D QSAR are very, very popular. In 4D QSAR, other than 3D, you also use the multiple conformation, orientation, and protonated state of the ligands. So then it will be a lot of diversity. So each molecule have a few hundred, may have a few hundred conformation and also orientation and protonation state. If you consider all this, then it will become 4D QSAR. But considering all this for 5 million molecule will not be a very good idea. It will take ages to complete this task, and then the region for doing QSAR you will lose. But then also we have 5D QSAR, where all the features of 4D plus up to 6 different local induced fit protocols. So if you apply induced fit protocols to 4D QSAR, then it will become 5D QSAR, which will increase the time and increase the effort a few fold if you want to include the induced fit information in the 4D. Now comes 6D QSAR. 6D QSAR is inclusion of solvation model. So how molecule behave in various solvent, how it behaves in water, how it behaves in toluene, how it behaves in many other solvent. If you can include that information, then it will become 6D QSAR. But as I said that 6D QSAR, it will be very, very difficult to use, because you may not be able to have all the information of shape of the molecule, of all the conformation, orientation, protonation state, and then various induced fit modeling, and then also solvation. If you include all this, then it will be very difficult to make a good QSAR model. So that is why either 2D QSAR model or 3D QSAR model are recommended, and they are also very popular and also very successful. Now we explain about descriptors. What are descriptors? So in the world of Torricini and Ponzani, the molecular descriptor is the final result of a logic and mathematical procedure which transforms chemical information encoded within a symbolic representation of a molecule into a useful number, or the result of some standardized experiment. Well, very complicated explanation. But if you say in very simple word, descriptors are defined as numerical characteristics associated with the chemical structure, or the properties in numbers that describe the activity of the molecule. So it is very important to understand descriptors before you perform any kind of QSAR. Descriptors are nothing but the representation of the properties of that lead or that ligand in numbers. That is called descriptors. That it can be any number, like molecular weight, like how many carbon atoms this ligand has, or how many bonds it has, how many double bond it has, how many fluorine atom it has, or any kind of information which is from the structure, which you can reflect in numbers, it will be called descriptor. If you want to classify descriptors in various groups, there are constitutional descriptors, topological descriptors, geometrical descriptors, electrostatic descriptors, quantum chemical descriptors, thermodynamic and DFT based descriptors. There can be many other kind of descriptors. So anything which you can get from the structure is a descriptor. But for the sake of clarity, we have classified the descriptors into these groups, and one can make another group like other descriptors. So if you talk about constitutional descriptor, that is like from the name it is very clear that it is the information of constitution of the structure, like total number of atoms, like how many carbon, how many hydrogen, and how many other atoms are there, and absolute and relative number of certain chemical groups and functionalities, total number of bonds, and all these kind of how many single bond, how many double bond, how many rings are there, and total number of how many six-membered ring, molecular weight, and average atomic weight. all this kind of information is called constitutional descriptor because it explains the constitution of the molecule. Now, the descriptors which can explain the topology of the molecule is called topological descriptors. This all can be calculated by using various kind of softwares which are available freely online, like Wiener index and connectivity index and Malvern's index, Kier's index, and many others. This is called topological descriptors. Now, the descriptor which can talk about the geometry of the molecule is called geometrical descriptors, like molecular surface area, solvent accessible molecular surface area, volume, solvent excluded volume, gravitational index, and many other kind of geometrical descriptors which explain the geometry of the molecule. Any descriptor derived from the 3D structure of the molecule is called geometrical descriptor. So 3D structure of the molecule, please don't confuse with the protein. This is only about the ligand. Ligand 3D structure, if you derive some kind of feature in numbers, that will be called geometrical descriptor. And then electrostatic descriptors. They are single values that give information about the molecular charge distribution. So it can be any kind of charge, molecule charge or Gesteiger or Jeffreys or polarity parameters, dipole moment, polarizability, or ionization energy, and any kind of electrostatic descriptors. So this will be called electrostatic descriptors. Now one can do quantum chemical descriptors. So this is very high quality descriptors which we get after we perform quantum chemical calculations using any kind of software like Gaussian. So if we perform quantum chemical calculations, we get values like highest occupied molecular orbitals, lowest unoccupied molecular orbitals, charges on specific atoms, electron density, electrostatic potential based parameters, and several other descriptors will be called quantum chemical descriptors. This will be based on quantum chemical calculations. Once you have all these quantum chemical descriptors, you can mix these quantum chemical descriptors with other geometrical and topological and structural and all other descriptors to generate a good model. So there are also called thermodynamic descriptors, which explain the vibrational enthalpy of the molecule or translational enthalpy or entropy or heat capacity of the molecule. This is all called thermodynamic descriptors. So this also can be included in the pool to get a good model, because the thermodynamic properties are very important for any molecule to explain the activity. So if you can get some very good thermodynamic descriptor in your model, there is a good chance that you will get a good model. We have tested a lot about density-based reactivity descriptors in last 15 years, like chemical hardness, global softness, chemical potential. I will explain about all these in the coming slides. Electronic charge and several other kind of DFT-based reactivity descriptors. So hardness is defined as the second derivative of energy with respect to the number of electrons and fixed external potential. And if you get the value of HOMO and LOMO, it is very easy to get the chemical hardness, and this is explained in this reference which is given below. It gives information about the reactivity of a molecule. If hardness value is large, then the molecule is less reactive. So usually we get a very good correlation between chemical hardness and any kind of activity we are going to use if we have very similar structure. If we have diverse structure, then this chemical hardness is not working enough. Global softness is also one kind of descriptor which is very close to chemical hardness, and it can also be calculated by using LUMO and HOMO values. One can get the details from this reference. So chemical potential can be used when there are structural diversity in the molecule. I mean, not a lot of diversity, some small structural diversity in the data set. If it is there, then one should use chemical potential as a descriptor, and it will be helpful to generate a good model. If you have a lot of diversity in your data set, like there are many small structure, many big structure, there are a lot of variation in the substitution and all, then it will be good to use electrophilicity index as a descriptor, which you can get from chemical potential and hardness. It is represented by omega, or you can also use maximum electronic charge. So if you have less diversity in your data set, hardness is good descriptor. If you have very huge diversity, electrophilicity index is a good descriptor. How to proceed for generating the QSAR model? So first, selection of a series of compounds. You take some 100 or 200 or 1000, as much as you can get the structure of the molecule. Then some traditional structure activity relationship. Then we have to go for calculation of descriptor. If you can afford to perform quantum mechanical calculation before descriptor selection, it will be good. Otherwise, one can do energy minimization by using any molecular mechanics based method and calculate the descriptor. And then building the QSAR model of the whole set without division in the training and test set. Once you complete this task, then we go for training and test set division. And then we do for model generation on the training set and apply training set equations to test set. And then we design a hypothetical compound for the prediction. And if those hypothetical compounds are giving the good activity value, we go for experimental work. So it means that if you get a model, suppose you get a model where you say that you put electrophilicity index as a descriptor and charge on nitrogen atom as a descriptor, these two descriptors are able to explain the activity of the molecule, then you can predict the, you can change some of, you can replace the substituents from some of the structures and then can predict the activity. And once you predict the activity, you can seek for experimental collaboration and test those molecules which you have predicted as higher active molecules. So, but if you have a little information of structure also, that is called integration of ligand and structure based approach. It means if you have information of the active site, information of the binding site of the protein, then you can calculate, you can get the descriptors based on molecular docking calculations, based on several other structure based approaches, based on molecular dynamics simulations. These descriptors, if you can get and can mix with the ligand based approaches or 2D based approach descriptors, then it will be called an integrative approach. This is also a very good approach to go forward if you have the structural information. So you can combine docking, molecular dynamics, pharmacophore, QSAR, and several others to find the better molecules. So you can take descriptors like interaction energy once you perform molecular dynamics simulation. So interaction energy as a descriptor, or docking score as a descriptors, or number of hydrogen bonds in docking as a descriptors, and several other parameters which you get from docking or molecular dynamics, you can use them as a descriptor with the 2D based descriptors to generate a good model and to generate a good QSAR activity. So once I think this structure based and integration of this approaches, it will be explained in detail in the coming days. So I am not going to talk much about it, but I think the best approach is to go for the integration of ligand and structure based techniques. And one has to be very cautious for mixing this ligand and structure based, because if you get any wrong information because of the wrong binding to the binding site, or because of the wrong interaction energy, or because of the wrong docking score, the whole data will be wasted. The whole exercise will be wasted. So you have to be very cautious before going for 3D. You must understand that it has to be a well-defined binding site. It has to be a well-validated molecular dynamics simulation, and it has to be also be a well-validated docking calculations before you take descriptors from those places. So I think I already explained about the pharmacophore, why different kind of structures are having very high or very low activity. This can be explained by pharmacophore. We also applied this type of ligand based and structure based approaches very recently to find some lead molecules against COVID-19. And we utilized the computer-aided drug design technique to search for the peptide-based inhibitor and also for the small molecules. We have utilized similarity search to identify similar compounds reported earlier for CoV-1-MPro, that is the 3D structure, that is protease, which is available in the protein data bank. We have taken the protease structure, which is also with one small molecule. We have first taken out that small molecule, and then we have tested our docking protocols by docking that molecules to the protease. Once the docking is done, we have superimposed the docked pose on the crystallographic pose. And the root mean square deviation between the crystallographic pose and the docked pose was less than 2 angstrom, which shows that our docking protocol was good. So then we have used that docking protocol, and we have taken more than 5 million molecules from Campbell and Jing databases and several FDA approved drugs and all, and then perform similarity search, then perform docking and rescoring to get some best molecules. So we also have taken all the FDA approved drugs for docking calculations, other than 5 million molecules taken from various libraries, and generated poses we are superimposed over co-crystallite poses to check the reliability of the results. And then we have selected some top compounds for molecular dynamics simulations. Our MD data shows that these docked poses are stable enough during the simulation and does not go high flexibility. You can see that this is all only 2 angstrom or below 2 angstrom in all the cases, the flexibility of protein. So based on these techniques, we have proposed 300 potential compounds from various databases which can be tested against COVID-19. Pharmacological, preclinical, and clinical studies are required to validate these findings. But besides, we have also identified 66 FDA-approved drugs where any kind of testing is not required. These 66 drugs show very high binding affinity and also are stable during the simulation. So one can test these 66 molecules against COVID-19. And we have ranked them in order, what is the best molecule and the second best and third best, all these 300 and all these 66. And these are the chemical structure of the selected best molecule and also the one which is available in the protein data bank. One can get all the details from this reference. Other than this, we also performed anti-malaria and anti-human African trypanosomiasis compounds, where these are the two important diseases, TBR and PF, Plasmodium falciparum and Trypanosoma brucei rhodiacensis. So these affects people in poor or underdeveloped countries, and this target for this is DNA minor groove binders. So we have taken various structures available in the literature and perform the multiple linear regression analysis after we do DFT calculations on all those ligands and all those 137 ligands. And then we have calculated the correlation coefficient of on all these molecules, which shows that our model is good and will be able to predict the activity of unknown molecules. We have divided them in the training and test set, and we also did for various number of descriptors, like 5 descriptors and 6 descriptors for PF, for TBR, and also for CL6. And all these correlation coefficient and cross validation coefficient values indicate that our generated model is good enough for the prediction of any unknown molecules. One can get more detail from the below reference. We have also included delta TM, which was available for only 35 molecules, and have divided them into training and test set, and calculated with the help of 6 descriptors. We got some very good statistical parameters for prediction of delta TM values. So we wanted to test this to several other diseases, and one of the diseases which we selected is tuberculosis, because 1/3 of the world population is infected with Mycobacterium tuberculosis, and approximately 10 million people each year get this infection. And one of the top 10 causes of death worldwide is because of Mycobacterium tuberculosis. For the past 5 years, it has been the leading cause of death from a single infection agent, ranking above HIV and AIDS. So recent report of WHO shows that nearly 1 in 5 Tibetan refugees, school children, has tuberculosis infection. So because of all these issues, we have decided to apply our technique for generating new lead molecule against Mycobacterium tuberculosis. We have collected around 850 molecules from various literature with the experimental activity values. And we have optimized all these molecules using DFT based methods. And also we have generated around 6,000 molecules from DFT optimization to have a database for the prediction of unknown molecules, or to select some molecules for to apply this to any kind of diseases. This model may be used to predict the biological activity of any unknown molecules against TB. And we can see that we have some very good correlation coefficient and also cross validation coefficient for the prediction. This is very clear from this graph, which shows the experimental activity versus predicted activity. So G quadruplex is a potential drug target of cancer. So we wanted to test the reliability of these techniques on variety of diseases and variety of problem of the society, and one of them is cancer. So what we did, we have taken some 750 molecules, which are G quadruplex binders, and they go and bind in the with the DNA, and this binding we have we performed various kind of docking studies by using several receptors, and also performed DFT optimization on all these molecules to generate data set. So 16 different PDB IDs we have used, which are given here. These PDB IDs we have used for docking, and we have used bold docking protocol. And we have selected the one which gave the best result in docking for further processing for molecular dynamics and other studies. These are the various kind of activity we can see that in most of these places we have correlation coefficient very high. Some places it is low also, but that is acceptable because it is for more than 300 molecules and if we can get around 60% success, it is a good model. And sometimes we had correlation coefficient close to 90, and all these models was validated with so much of training and test set validation, applicability domain, and several other structural parameters. And this model is very good model. So other than this, we are also working on modeling MDM2 inhibitors, which is protein-protein interaction inhibitors, and this may help to understand cancer in a much better way, where we are where we got some very good correlation coefficient, but top 5 compounds we are subjected for bioassays also, which gave promising results. And one can see in this graph that our generated models and our generated structures are able to get some good results in the experiment. So basically what I wanted to tell here is that ligand based approaches can be utilized for prediction of any kind of activity or property. We ourselves has tested this on various kind of this is all recent work. When I was working in IICT, we have tested on several others like HIV and cancer and various kind of other structure activity relationship, and all that is available in the literature. So what advanced approach can be used now is to apply various kind of machine learning techniques, various kind of random forest and other techniques to generate more efficient model, or to generate models efficiently. Both things, more efficient model and efficiently generate model. We have tested it on thousands of molecules. We have tested it on hundreds of various tests, various receptors, various structures available in the protein data bank. We have tested it on various diseases like TB, like HIV, like malaria, cancer, and several other, where we are able to get some structure which are good, and then which are not only good, they are able to have very good interaction with the receptor. In the prediction, they are able to predict some good values, and then we are making some kind of experimental collaboration so that those things can be tested. But since this is a training program, I wanted to give much more details, and that's why I have given details like what kind of structure and how. But the take home message is that if you want to generate a QSAR model, first thing, your data should be clean as you can have, otherwise it will not be a good. Second thing, you must get the chemical structure minimized or optimized properly with the correct conformation, with the correct orientation, and with the correct information, whatever you can get. So if you can have these two things, there is a very good chance that you will get a good QSAR model. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, actually that in the YouTube we have a series of questions in your lecture, that whatever you have explained till now. So already one lecture regarding QSAR was detailed, that mathematical equation was explained by Dr. Kunal Roy. So in addition to that, today you have explained how to apply the QSAR model in drug discovery approaches. So yeah, there are number of questions. So due to time constraint, I will take a couple of questions. So actually Abhishek Jha, he is asking, what is the average number? I mean, how many total number of compounds can be included in order to generate the best QSAR model?
There are no limit for number of molecules. The more number, the better is the model. But one, as I said many times, that those molecules who, whatever you are including in the data set, they has to be minimized, and their activity should be from the same series, from the same lab, from the same method, and identical. But there are no limit for the number of molecules.
Thank you, sir. And the same person, he also would like to ask, like, is there any best QSAR method available for medicinal herbs? I mean, medicinal plant compounds, as well as already what is available as drugs.
So QSAR method is not like it will be available. You have to generate a model, and for generating a model, you need not use any kind of software and all. What you can do is, whatever natural products you have with the activity, you make it a clean data of those natural products, minimize those structure of those natural products, calculate the descriptors, and then on the basis of multiple linear regression analysis, or if the data set is very high, you can use machine learning. That techniques you can use to generate an equation which will be able to predict the activity of unknown molecule. So you need not have any kind of available model. For each kind of test, you need to have to generate a new model. And generating a model, you have to start from the data set, a clean data set.
Sir, one last question. Actually, this question asked by so many people. And because since that you have mentioned like QSAR can be generated based on different type of descriptors, so how we can calculate the descriptors, as well as, I mean, you have mentioned 1D, 2D, 3D. So what will give the best result as far as QSAR concerned?
So for that, you have to calculate the descriptors by minimizing the, after you minimize the structure or you optimize the structure, you get so much of numbers in the log file. From there, you can get the descriptor, like your charge on carbon atom, like how many molecules are, how many carbon atoms are there, what is the molecular weight of that molecule, various kind of descriptors, topological descriptors, geometrical descriptors, and quantum chemical descriptors. Like also, I also explained how to get chemical potential and many other descriptors. Once you get some 300, 400 or whatever descriptor you can have, then you perform multiple linear regression analysis to select the best descriptors or best five descriptors. So one, first you do like one descriptor you take and perform the correlation coefficient and then get the correlation coefficient values, and then with two descriptor and then with three descriptor, and then you stop at a point where you get the maximum number. The maximum number doesn't mean that you should get one. Suppose if you are having if you use two descriptor and your correlation coefficient is 0.5, and if you use three descriptor, your correlation coefficient becoming 0.7, then it will be very good to move from two descriptor to three descriptor. But if you are having, like, if you move from three to four and your correlation coefficient increases from 0.70 to 0.71, there is no point of increasing the number of descriptors. So at that point, you have to stop. So like that, you need to check, you need to validate, and then you need to select the best descriptors for that particular model. And once you generate the model, it will be valid only for that molecule for which it was generated.
So thank you very much, sir. So now we would like to conclude this session. So on behalf of DDGATS 2020 training team, I thank Dr. Hemant Kumar Srivastava to give a lecture on QSAR as well as their application over there in the drug discovery. So now, thank you, sir. So there is an announcement for the participant. So without any further delay, within another 10 minutes, we will join with the vertical 2 session. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
सर हम नेक्स्ट 5 to 10 मिनट्स में स्टार्ट